What is up, everybody? Welcome to another installment of the Beer Flow Podcast. This is Greg, your boy, and all right, let's roll. Let's roll into this. So, in the last episode or a few episodes before, I had alluded to, let's just say I teased ahead, and I had alluded to maybe a sticker or a label or some sort of like, you know, insignia signifying that a beer, a craft beer in particular, was independent. And while doing the research for this episode, something came up, and it was pretty cool. The Brewers Association launched a seal to designate independent beers. The seal itself, to give you a little description of what the seal looks like, the seal is the bottle. It's upside down, and the bottle itself is black, and inside of the bottle, written in white, are the words broken up in three parts, independent. Now, why is that significant? Why should we care? Well, I'm going to let... Okay, so... I teased ahead. I knew. Okay, let's just face it. Let's just call a spade a spade. Let's call it as I had heard about this, and while I was doing research for a different episode, and then I kind of went into the rabbit hole, and holy shit, it was just crazy. So much stuff had been happening. Breweries were getting scooped up left and right. I just felt like I'm like, what? Where are all my breweries going? You know, where are all the ones that I love? You know, what's going on? Who's buying who? Some of those just got sold, isn't it? I know. Okay. So, if you've caught any of our previous episodes, you know that I have a long, around-the-world way of explaining things. So, digging into this rabbit hole, I went to the Brewers Association website and read through what this whole seal sticker was going to be for craft beer. So, it's from what I gather, you can get this seal put on to your cans, your bottles, your brewery, what have you. So, when they did a press release, this is what the first two paragraphs said. I'm going to read. Excuse me if I mess up my public speaking and reading voice. In an effort to educate beer lovers about which beers are independently produced, the Brewers Association, the not-for-profit trade group dedicated to promoting and protecting America's small and independent craft brewers, launched a new seal touting independent craft brewers. Next paragraph. Featuring an iconic beer bottle shape flipped upside down with the seal captures the spirit with which craft brewers have upended beer while informing beer lovers they are choosing a beer from a brewery that is independently owned, period. These breweries run their business free of influence from other alcohol beverage companies which are not themselves craft brewers. End quote. Okay. So, that being said, let's go to the next question. What does it all mean? What does it mean to you? What does it mean to you as a consumer? What does it mean to you as a craft beer drinker, craft beer lover? All right, so let's just put that aside for just a sec. And who's left? Who's still independent craft? All right, so let's run through a few questions you can ask yourself to see if the beer you're drinking is an independently owned craft beer, craft brewery. Question one, does it have the Brewer's Independent seal? All right, look for the seal. You should see it somewhere on the bottle, maybe on the packaging. Do you have to go to the brewery directly to get their beer? Okay, next question. Are there long lines for can or bottle releases at said brewery? Okay, next question. Do they quickly run out of these beers that get quote-unquote limited or even for some of the regular releases, do these beers run out? Okay. Are these beers that you are drinking, for the most part, only available in your state? That's a good one. And last question. I'm sorry, that was the last question. That was the last question. My bad. Okay, so if you've answered yes to any of these questions, chances are that the beer that you're drinking comes from an independent craft brewery. All right, so why all the talk of independence? What's the big deal? Who cares? Well, there's this old thing about, you know, the world is run by 10% of, it was like 10% of the world's money is controlled by like 10 corporations or 4 corporations, something crazy like that. But anyway, that's neither here nor there, kind of. Okay, so why all this talk of independence? Well, probably because more and more breweries are no longer independent. What we're starting to find lately, especially in the past two to three years, I've been seeing a lot more. All these craft breweries are independent, are no longer independent, or they're teaming up, or they're getting bought out, or, some people believe that, at one time there were major breweries. Let me rephrase that. So somebody once told me, hey, I like craft beers. I like Blue Moon. Well, they were craft a long time ago when they first came out, but then, they got scooped up by Miller. What are you going to do? And what we're starting to see is that's happening a lot more and more. And I don't want to say the worst, but to some people, it is kind of like I said previously, my interview with Michael LaCrosse from Morgan Territory. To me, it's kind of like loving an independent band, and you love that band and they're so cool, but not everyone knows them. Not a lot of people have heard of them. And actually, another thing about it, there was this really funny story I heard a comedian say, and he was talking about the group Arctic Monkeys. Now, if you've ever heard of them, awesome. If not, just deal with me for a second. I love Arctic Monkeys. It's this great band and nobody's really heard of them, but they're so awesome. And the next thing you know, they're on Saturday Night Live. They're the musical guests. I'm like, oh, well, yeah, that's cool. But then they go on Saturday Night Live, and everyone loves Arctic Monkeys. And you're like, oh, God, I hate that everyone loves them now. I'm kind of like that. I'm not going to lie. I like the fact that there are certain things that only I know about, or only a handful of people know about, and I think is really cool, and they think it's cool, so we're cool for that. It's stupid. I know. It is. But essentially, you want people to, when you create something, you want everyone to love it. And I get that. But then on the flip side, there are times that people just kind of do this as a money grab, where people like literally set up to get bought out. We've heard people tell stories about that exact thing happening, where they were almost set up to be bought. I don't know. It's crazy. So, we've talked about some independent breweries that have been bought. And for a lot of times, I've defended it. I've defended, it's strictly distribution, for those reasons only, this and that, blah, blah, blah. But based on this criteria that the Brewers Association is putting out to have this to have this independent seal, this independent sticker on your product, if you're a brewery, who's left? Well, let's give you a little rundown to see who's left. Not to completely like shit on people or to shit on any brewery, whatever, because people love what they love, they like what they like, and I get that. But, to me, I feel that It's kind of like when people in the FDA started putting the nutritional value on food, on packages, to let you know how much of this is in there, what percentage, and you're, you know, based on your daily amount and all that. Okay. So I think this is, I'd like to think that I'm kind of doing a service as to letting you know some of the big guys. But I'm not going to completely shit on them. I will give you the silver lining, or the good and bad, the yin to yang of some of these deals. And mind you, I wasn't going to be able to get to all of the deals that have happened in the past 3 years. These are just some of the more significant ones that I noticed. And chances are, if I noticed them, I'm sure you have too. But all right, so the first one, like Ballast Point out of San Diego. I know that we've talked about it before. They were bought by Constellation for, I think, $1 billion. I don't know, some crazy amount. But I don't want to get into the numbers as far as, you know, how much they're bought for, whatever. To me, that's a little messy. I'm not going to get into that. But yeah, but like Ballast, you know, they're bought by Constellation. Constellation, they are a, you know, a beer and spirits company. They own Corona. They own Svedka Vodka. And for some of you day drinking house moms, Arbor Mist, you know, they own that. I mean, so I guess the silver lining for that is, yeah, it's definitely a distribution move. So if you think about it, you can go to a grocery store and you can see Ballast Point. You can get a Sculpin. All right. Thanks. One of the big ones that I saw this year that really kind of, I don't know, it kind of bummed me out a little bit. The brewery's over 121 years old. It's one of America's oldest craft breweries. The iconic San Francisco craft brewery, Anchor Brewing, they sold to Sapporo. I mean, Jesus. That's a San Francisco staple. I mean, to give you an example, the very first podcast we did was at The Yard, which is outside of AT&T Park across from a Covey Cove. That the beer they serve there is Anchor. I love Anchor. You know, Anchor Steam is probably one of California's first craft beers that's beloved. I mean, the silver lining for that, I mean, it's got it is worldwide distribution. And I get it. I mean, hell, I went to Giants games and I would, you know, I'd get a blueberry IPA just because I knew it was Anchor, and then this happens. That this was, you know, just recently. So, okay. 2 years ago, another brewery that was a little bit more on the down low, you know, not that they need to advertise or anything, but, you know, whatever. But Firestone Walker, if you've had a Firestone Walker, you know, the Double Barrel Ale, the Union, their Union Jack, East Jack, all those. I mean, they're good beers, but, you know, literally just about 2 years ago, they were bought by Duvel. Duvel, the Belgian beer company. They also have a couple other breweries that people may not know that were owned by Duvel, but Boulevard Brewing and Omegang. I always say, I hope I'm pronouncing it right. I believe it's Omegang, which most recently people probably noticed, and they've gained a little more notoriety. It's because they're the brewery that puts out the 750 milliliters of the Game of Thrones beer bottles. So the silver lining with that. Well, the one cool thing is that, you know, Firestone, they're still doing like their barrel age stuff, all their experimental bottle age stuff. It's still quality. Oh, and right now their Leo versus Ursus, man, that stuff is great. They're already on their second one. I believe it's gonna end soon. Hopefully they have a third and a fourth going, because those are some really, really good IPAs they're putting out, with the Leo versus Ursus. All right, so like another, okay, this one, just this summer, speaking of Constellation, they also purchased South Florida's Funky Buddha. Now, I seen somebody post on one of the Instagram accounts that I follow. Oh, yeah, please, if you get a chance, check us out on Instagram, The Beer Flow on Instagram. But I've seen on Instagram somebody I was following, they had posted a picture of one of the Funky Buddha beers. And I was like, man, I know I've heard of them for years. You know, they put out some, it was a crazy stout. Excuse me. I don't remember which one it was, but I just remember hearing Funky Buddha, you know, out of Florida, Funky Buddha, South Florida, blah, blah, blah. They just got bought by Constellation. Silver lining? I don't know. I got nothing. I mean, hopefully they come out to California. Maybe Texas. I don't know. Texas, you know, they come out to Austin. D, hook me up. My boy D out in Austin. Hopefully he can hook me up. I don't know. I mean, hopefully that's, you know, that was the move. Speaking of Florida, one of, and I do not say this lightly, but there's some years that this has been considered one of the best IPAs in the country. And that's the Highlight IPA by Cigar City Brewing. I know some people have gotten their hands on it here in California, and they've said it's incredible, it's great. Some people said it rivals Pliny, even though one's a double, you know, whatever. More than likely, you've heard of Highlight IPA in the can. Now, what was crazy about that is they were almost, I mean, almost sold to AB. But apparently, according to the article, at the last second, Cigar City pulled out, and they joined, and I want to say, it really didn't allude that they were bought, but they did mention the word partnered, and this was a marriage. They partnered up with Oscar Blues out of Colorado. Now, I love Oscar Blues. They do great, great stuff. And, you know, definitely a silver lining with that. For me, there were two silver linings. One, they didn't get bought by AB. So, you know, thank you for that. Another one was that, you know, both Oscar Blues and Cigar City, they're pretty much known for their canning. And in the article, it said something that they were literally, Cigar City was running out of runway space. So I can only hope that, you know, whatever deal was made for those guys, it was strictly distribution, maybe to get more cans out. And if anyone knows how to do cans, it's definitely Oscar Blues. They're going to, you know, I can only assume they have the facilities to sit there and help them out and do what they get here in California. That's what I can hope for. Honestly, that's all that hopefully that you can hope for. Now, there's one more major deal. Well, there's two, but the one major deal that I did want to bring up, I'm not going to bring up right now, only because I am going to dedicate an entire episode to that deal. Mainly because it's from two of my favorite breweries. If you've listened to the podcast, if you've heard some of our prior episodes, you may have an idea as to what I'm talking about. If you kind of follow Beer Geek news, and you may know what I'm talking about. But like I said, I'm going to say that for an entire episode. So I'll keep you posted, and I'll get back to you on that one. So I guess that's kind of it. I mean, all right. So let's rewind. Let's bring it all back. So I'll ask you again. If you haven't already asked yourself, you know, what does it all mean? Is all craft beer independent? ? Are you going to be an absolute stickler as to whatever you drink has to be and has to have that little independent seal? Or are you of the mindset that, you know, ignorance is bliss? And you don't care. You know, I don't know. I can't answer that for you. you need to come up with your own answer for that. But I mean, at least there's, you know, well, okay, well, at least one thing's for sure. And whether or not it has a sticker of an upside down bottle or not, at least hopefully it's not a B minus or a C minus. And I don't know if you guys have ever heard me use those terms, but if you ever heard anyone here at the Beer Flow say B minus, C minus, that is referring to a Bud Light or a Coors Light. So, I don't know. You choose how independent you want your craft beer to be. Me, I'll just share with you whatever I decide to drink, but more importantly, whatever I decide to share with you guys. 15 for 12 coming right up. What I've decided is for this week's 15 for 12, in keeping with the independent slash got bought, not independent, whatever, I am going to have a beer that is, you know, that. All right, let's just face it. Firestone, they make some great beers. And especially, like I said, especially their barrel-aged stuff. But the Leo versus Ursus, this is the second beer that they have. This is their Adversus. I believe the first one was Fortum. I don't know, Greek mythology. Not good at it. But this one is their summer release. It's getting towards the end. This is the second series, or the second beer in their series of the Leo versus Ursus. Like I said, it was their summer release, and this was a really, really good beer for summer. Comes in a 16-ounce can. If you purchase it for retail, you can get it on tap. I've seen it on tap places, but they come in a 4-pack of 16-ounce cans. Okay, so looking at it, very summery as far as like that kind of golden. It's an unfiltered double IPA, 8.2 ABV. Oh, okay. So on the nose, you definitely get some of the, a little bit tropical, a little pineapple-y, a little mango-y. It actually drinks a little warm in the sense that, you know, it is a little bit higher in ABV, and you can kind of tell, but nothing too crazy. You know, the way it was kind of promoted and advertised, it's a great summer drink, great summer beer. Okay, yes, I can see myself drinking this maybe when the sun goes down. It's still a little warm outside, but still, you know, you're still good enough to sit there and handle something with a little bit higher ABV. But it's great. I'm not going to be that particular about, you know, exactly how independent it is. And I know, you know, Duvel, yeah, they're a Belgian beer company, but, you know, Duvel makes great Belgian beer too. So I don't know. I leave it up to you. But for our 15 for 12, I am definitely drinking this Firestone Leo versus Ursus Adversus. That's a lot to say. And hold on. Oh, yeah. So, yeah, the release for this, I believe, ends fairly soon. So if you see it, definitely pick it up. Definitely drink it. You know, don't sit it down. Don't sit on it for a while because, you know, the flavor will change a little bit. And that's it. That's all I got. I'm going to finish this beer. I know we've been talking about the business of beer. We're going to have some fun fairly soon. I've teased ahead in the sense that we are going to, the Beer Flow will be at the Great American Beer Festival. Cannot wait. Looking forward to it. This is outside of, you know, the vacations I take with my wife. This is pretty much, it's like a lifetime dream to do this. Can't wait. Hit us up on all of our socials, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. Check us out on Untappd. Like I said, we friend everyone. Let us know what you're drinking, especially since we're going to be in Colorado. Let us know where to go, where we should go, what we should drink. Not going to leave you without a jam of the week. This jam of the week, is very, very strategic in when I picked this jam of the week. I had a lot going on. Like I said, we like to work on levels. And I picked this song because this kind of mirrored what I thought about the whole craft breweries being bought by bigger breweries. It's pretty woo. This is from the 1990 album Business as Usual. It's by the group EPMD. EPMD, if you don't know who they are, okay, I get it. You probably heard a song or two that, you know, you'd recognize if you heard it. But EPMD was this really awesome duo, Eric Parrish and Eric Smith and Parrish making dollars. EPMD, they were this great underground group, this duo that just had great songs. You got to chill. And they started gaining this really cool cult following. People loved them. And they were on a small independent label. And then they were picked up by Def Jam. This album, Business as Usual, this was their first major label release. And this album doesn't disappoint. This is a great album. It really showcased what they had as far as talent. You know, with the major label, the production was polished up. Their songs were polished up. And because they were under that Def Jam umbrella, they pulled out one of what I think is one of the best microphone performance featured rapper spots ever, period, hands down. And because LL Cool J was under the Def Jam umbrella, he blessed him with one of I think is his greatest bars ever. So this week's Jam of the Week from the Beer Flow. 1999's Business as Usual is the album. The song Rampage by EPMD featuring LL Cool J. I hope you enjoy it. I know you recognize the beat. Thank you so much, everyone, for the love and support. We love seeing you and hearing you. We can't wait to catch up with all of you guys. Thank you so much for the love and support. It really means a lot. And don't forget our motto here at the Beer Flow. We believe in dreamers, especially if you believe and dream of pursuing the American dream, especially if you're dreaming of making that next great American craft beer. We're with you. On behalf of myself, Einstein, Real Deal, we'll catch you guys next time. Peace. 'Cause I clock cheese while you clock Z's, and I don't smoke crack. I smoke MCs, so pick up a pen, cop a squat, and take notes. My rap, I suffer from bleeding, sprains, and slit throats. 'Cause my style, deadly psychopath, schizophrenic. A rapper choke like a carburetor, freeze up a panic. 'Cause I clock pesos, don't say yay, yo. Another word for cocaine, mi amigo. That's Spanish, terminology for friend. Now sit back and rob my Bozak as I sin. Bass funk, with beats that thump. For kickers and amps, co lined up in my trunk. My system cranking, my headlights are blinking. Brothers riding my tip L, and at the same time thinking, damn, how could a brother be so nice? 'Cause I'm the capital PE twice, MDE twice. I choose to squeeze, some choose to fight. I like to write, but then again, some bite. And while you was banging on tables, I was banging Snow White. Slow down, baby. Yeah, slow down, baby.